The world is, once again, or still, I guess, looking kind of bleak. Everywhere you turn, there's bad news. Inflation, war, violence, another disease to be terrified of, political shenanigans, and of course, it's summer, so a lot of the planet is back to being on fire. The world is bad. Other people are bad, and hope is for the foolish and the weak. Pessimism is everywhere in fiction, too. It seems, by and large, that if a writer wants their book or movie or show to be taken seriously or signal that it's for adults, it must be dark, gritty, and hopeless. Characters should be deep in despair with no way out. After all, you can't be a serious adult without depression. It isn't a successful day without a gritty retelling of a beloved childhood classic. And if any character does possess a shred of positive outlook for the future, obviously it needs to be tortured out of them. Optimism is for children, because every adult knows that the real world is full of terrible people doing terrible things to each other. Right and wrong, or good and bad, don't even really exist. It's silly and naive to think that things could ever change for the better. At least, that's according to many of the stories we've been telling each other for the last several years. I've talked previously about how the stories that get created tend to reflect the way writers and producers perceive reality. And look, it's obviously true that the world contains all sorts of horrible people. Heck, even in the safest and freest parts of the world, some people build their entire personality around being garbage. But I would still argue that pessimism is the childish outlook, not optimism. So come along with me on a journey through Middle-earth, the multiverse, and finally, all the way to rural Texas on this second-to-last episode of Out of Frame. It doesn't happen all that often anymore, but once upon a time, stories commonly featured heroic characters working to overcome their own faults, fears, and limitations in order to make their worlds a little bit better, or even rid them of great evil. And while we like to think of heroes as being these big, tough, powerful men, some of the greatest and most iconic examples in literary and cinematic history have been anything but. In fact, this is one of the core themes of J.R.R. Tolkien's epic fantasy, The Lord of the Rings. In a world brought to the brink of destruction by a primordial demigod, the greatest armies of Middle-earth are no match for Sauron's power. And the battle against evil is not won by physical strength, skillful swordsmanship, or even incredible feats of magic. The whole point of the story is that evil is defeated by the most unassuming, literally the smallest of people, because they hold true to the one thing that evil cannot withstand, hope. And although the story focuses on Frodo Baggins and his journey to destroy the Ring of Power in the fires of Mount Doom, I'd argue that the most important hero of The Lord of the Rings is Sam. When we first meet Samwise Gamgee, he's introduced as an unremarkable hobbit, maybe even a bit dim.
Confound it all, Samwise Gamgee! Have you been eavesdropping?
I ain't been dropping no eaves, sir, honest.
And sure, Sam might be a bit naive to insist on joining Frodo, especially considering that he's never been outside the Shire before.
This is it. This is what? If I take one more step, it'll be the farthest away from home I've ever been.
Their quest isn't some easy, fun little trip to Bree or Bywater. Frodo and Sam cover hundreds of miles on foot. They face deadly monsters. They are betrayed by people they trust. They are relentlessly hunted by a supernatural force of pure evil. People they know and care about die. And all the while, the One Ring is corrupting Frodo. But Sam is there every step of the way, from the Shire to Mordor, watching as his best friend is gradually twisted and fundamentally broken by the task he's elected to bear. And for most of the journey, he can do nothing about it. Sam isn't a great leader like Aragorn. He doesn't have the keen senses and steady aim of Legolas. He isn't a mighty warrior like Gimli or a wizard like Gandalf. He's a gardener. And yet he has something that no one else in the entire Fellowship manages to have. An unshakable belief in the fundamental goodness of the world, and the belief that it can and will be restored. Even with the very embodiment of evil hunting and corrupting Frodo, with orcs and Uruk-hai, giant spiders and Gollum nipping at their heels, Sam sees goodness, light, and beauty, even in the darkest places.
I can't do this, Sam. I know. It's all wrong. It's like in the great stories, Mr. Frodo. The ones that really mattered. Full of darkness and danger they were. And sometimes you didn't want to know the end. How could the world go back to the way it was when so much bad had happened? But in the end, it's only a passing thing. This shadow. Even darkness must pass. Those were the stories that stayed with you. That meant something. Even if you were too small to understand why. But I think, Mr. Frodo, I do understand. I know now. Folk in those stories had lots of chances of turning back, only they didn't. They kept going. Because they were holding on to something. What are we holding on to, Sam? That there's some good in this world, Mr. Frodo. And it's worth fighting for.
That perspective is a matter of choice. Even when everything, everywhere feels like it's going wrong, Sam chooses to focus on what's going right. His determination to hold on to optimism isn't stupid or naive. It's deeply necessary. And in the end, after Frodo has lost sight of that goodness and succumbs to the influence of the ring, it is Sam who still has the strength and the willingness to finish the job. Sam, uneducated, unworldly, and yet stubbornly cheerful, is the one who ultimately saves the day.
There's nothing, no veil between me and the Wheel of Fire. I can see him with my waking eyes. Then let us be rid of it. Once and for all. Come on, Mr. Frodo. I can't carry it for you. But I can carry you.
If Sam had given up, if he had simply gone home weeks earlier when Gollum tricked Frodo into blaming him for running out of food, their entire world would have been lost. It's Sam's hope and love and his belief in the power of goodness that keeps him going. It's what prevents him from giving up on Frodo and what fuels him as he carries his friend to the peak of Mount Doom. In the end, it's Sam's philosophical outlook that saves all of Middle-earth. Another more recent example is Everything, Everywhere, All at Once. I did an entire video about the film and the dangers of nihilism, which I'll link to in the description, but there's another aspect to the story that I didn't talk about quite as much that is still just as important. If you've seen the film, you'll know that Evelyn is very much the protagonist of Everything, Everywhere, All at Once. It's her journey and character growth that saves her daughter Joy and stops her from destroying the universe. But much like Sam in The Lord of the Rings, it's Evelyn's husband Waymond, and not even the cooler alpha version of Waymond, who actually saves the day through his unsinkable optimism. The funny thing is, thanks to her own insecurity and depression, Evelyn typically finds Waymond's positivity to be extremely irritating.
Sorry, it was too crowded here, so I moved some upstairs. I think the clones are happier there. See? They're happier here.
不是说好了吗? 把全部这个Google Eyes拔下来. No more Google Eyes!
He's playful and silly. He insists on being friendly to everyone. The customers at the laundromat.
Evelyn, you have to see Rick Dash. Look, he knows all of the moves.
Even the IRS agent currently auditing them.
Last chance.
Oh, tomorrow is better.
Thank you. 6 p.m. Thank you so much.
Thank you for the cookies. They look delicious.
We learned that Waymond has always been this way. It's one of the reasons that Evelyn fell in love with him and why her father never liked him. He has a playfulness that is irrepressible. And since there is absolutely no sense of malice or sarcasm to his actions, most people tend to think of him as childish, especially Evelyn. She can't understand why he doesn't seem to be taking their challenges seriously. I mean, they're married. They both own and operate the same struggling laundromat together. They both raised the same moody and aimless daughter. They both have to deal with Evelyn's judgmental father. They're being audited. They've had to deal with the same set of inputs for the last 30 years, but they've reacted completely differently. Evelyn is surly and world-weary, while Waymond is cheerful and optimistic. Given that comparison, I can understand how someone would see Waymond as childish and unserious. In fact, the film largely plays his personality for laughs during the first two acts. But in reality, it is Waymond's perspective and his choice to be kind and gentle, to see goodness in the world, that makes all the difference.
Please, can we just stop fighting? I know you're all fighting because you're scared and confused. I'm confused too. All day. I don't know what the heck is going on. But somehow, this feels like it's all my fault. I don't know. The only thing I do know is that we have to be kind. Please, be kind. Especially when we don't know what's going on.
It's that moment that pulls Evelyn back from the edge of despair. It's Wayman's hope and optimism that saves her and gives her the power to save their daughter, which, once again, saves the entire multiverse. I describe Sam and Wayman's optimistic worldview as a choice, because it is. I appreciate that there are some innate personality differences that make it easier or harder for different individuals to stay positive. Some people are sort of wired to only see the worst in themselves and others. And if you're looking to find the dark side of humanity and human existence, it's never very far away. Chance or bad choices can bring disaster and heartache. Our health can fail us. Our best is not always good enough. The people we love can disappoint us. Life, in all its array of hardships, has a way of hurting people. But optimism isn't about not seeing the bad things in the world or being cheerful all the time for no reason. It isn't defined by playfulness or Google eyes or being enthusiastic about potatoes.
Potatoes!
No, optimism isn't about ignoring the bad parts of the world at all. It's about learning to focus on the good parts, which are, in fact, far more common. Optimists are hopeful for the future and believe that it will be better than what we have now, as long as we put in the work, which has been true for the entirety of human history. And that is the opposite of childish and irrational. What's more, a person's worldview tends to be self-fulfilling. If you believe the world can get better, if you believe in the goodness of other people and yourself, and if you believe that your actions can impact the future, or if you believe that the world is filled with horrors and darkness and that other people are a menace that mean you harm, you're probably right. That also happens to be the main lesson from one of the most underrated movies made this century, Secondhand Lions. Written and directed by Tim McAnally's, Secondhand Lions is a coming-of-age story set in rural Texas in the 1960s. It also happens to be one of my all-time favorite films. It stars Michael Caine and Robert Duvall as Garth and Hub McCann, two cantankerous old men who reluctantly take in their great-nephew, Walter, played by Haley Joel Osment. Walter is a good kid, but his mother is the worst.
The worst!
She's allowed her life to become a revolving door of abusive men and get-rich-quick schemes. And in spite of her stated love for her son, Walter has been neglected and lied to his entire life. So when he comes to live with his uncles, he finally gets a pair of legitimately good role models who teach him what it means to be a man. Hub and Garth have lived an epic life, but Walter struggles to trust anyone and often wonders if their stories are exaggerated or made up. But one of the more important themes in the movie is about whether or not Walter is even asking the right questions.
Those stories about Africa, about you, they're true, aren't they?
Doesn't matter.
It does too. Around my mom, all I hear is lies. I don't know what to believe in.
Damn, if you want to believe in something, then believe in it.
As someone who deeply values empiricism, rationality, and truth, I've always found it amusing how much I identify with this scene. Although, admittedly, a lot of Hub's stories do seem a little far-fetched, Walter's need to know the truth is coming from a place of insecurity and pain, not from a place of curiosity. So Hub decides that Walter needs to hear a part of the speech he often gives to young men. And honestly, it's one of the better bits of practical philosophy I've ever heard.
Sometimes the things that may or may not be true are the things that a man needs to believe in the most. That people are basically good. That honor, courage, and virtue mean everything. That power and money and power mean nothing. That good always triumphs over evil. And I want you to remember this, that love true love never dies. You remember that, boy. You remember that. Doesn't matter if it's true or not, you see. Man should believe in those things because those are the things worth believing in.
Hub is not saying that we should lie to ourselves or refuse to acknowledge reality. He's saying that what we believe about ourselves and others is what shapes our choices. The things you believe matter. They define your attitude and willpower. They determine your ability to be proactive, creative, entrepreneurial, and resourceful. They affect the way you treat other people and the way you're perceived and treated in return. Your philosophy is ultimately what guides your actions, and your actions are the cause of the effects you experience throughout your life. No matter what your challenges or where you start off, a good philosophy produces good results. A bad philosophy results in failure and despair. Hub's greatest gift to Walter was to replace the dishonesty, mistrust, and anxiety imparted to him by a deadbeat mother with a superior set of values and beliefs that serve him well into adulthood. It's easy to focus on the bad things, and it's hard to put in the work to overcome the basic obstacles that simple existence puts in our path, let alone the man-made horrors that some people are unfortunate enough to encounter along the way. Optimism isn't a personality trait. It's a life choice. And it's far more difficult and takes a lot more strength and bravery to stick to than pessimism does. Suffering is universal. We will all experience setbacks and have to deal with pain. But looking beyond the immediate struggle to the possibility of a better world is the only path that can lead to long-term success. Seeking the goodness in others and putting in the work to find or build something better is the soul of optimism. And that is as far from childish and irresponsible as you can get. If all you expect to see is badness, terror, and misery, that's all you'll ever find. Goodness and beauty become a fluke, a trick of statistics. But if you really open your eyes and look around, you'll find that the opposite is actually true. The overwhelming majority of your interactions with other people are almost certainly not traumatic or terrible. More importantly, regardless of whether or not that's objectively the reality for you at all times, maintaining an optimistic philosophy opens up a vast and gorgeous world of opportunity. So seek the good, be kind, and don't give up. Hey everybody, thanks for watching this episode of Out of Frame. As I said at the beginning, the next episode of this series will be the last. I'll talk about this a lot more next time, but I've really appreciated the opportunity to create impactful video essays like this for fee, and I will probably continue to play some role consulting on new shorts and main series on the channel going forward. But either way, I really just want to say thank you to everyone who has been a fan over the years. Not just our Patreon and Subscribestar supporters, though of course it's been amazing to see so many people willing to help fund the show, but also just everyone who has commented, liked, subscribed, and shared these videos with their friends. If not for people continuing to watch month after month, this series would have ended a long time ago. As always, click that bell icon to make sure you are the first to know when the final episode comes out and to hear all about our new content moving forward. But for now, I'll see you next time.